great Bishop Rance Allen and his dedication to the music, the gospel ministry, and those in Toledo, Ohio. He was a man of God, and we thank God for all his contributions and his sacrifice to the gospel and spreading the gospel, even out you out there in Facebook land. We all have been a part of the songs of Bishop Rance Allen, and we honor him, and we thank God for the instrument that God had used on this earth. And many others have transitioned. We thank God for those that endured. And I encourage you today, no matter how it looks, the just shall live by faith, and there is none greater than God. And we are trusting in him. I want to give, before we go to the word of God, which is so important, I want to give a praise out and recognition to the outreach team for yesterday, of all of the dedication that they dedicated themselves to our leader, Minister Robin White. We also had Minister Randy Rainey, hallelujah, that had it all set. And Minister Robin put the rules into place. Pastor Val had packed over 90-something bags of candy and make sure we had our masks and everything, our distance. We also had Elder Lamika, who not only came, but picked up other candy on the way and came, hallelujah, and brought a few soldiers, amen, to come and assist. We needed those soldiers. We had Lysandra, a.k.a. Lizzie, hallelujah, and we had Sister Adori that is growing, and this, hey, pretty soon will be 17, but she came and just ministered, and they helped us in the ministry. So I don't want to miss any of those. Also, the one that I had forbade to come, Sister Jamie, she showed up, and I forbade her to come because y'all know she's pregnant. But she came with a van full of children, and all the, and what they did was drove around and find other people, tell them to go get the tracts and go get the candies. We gave out Bibles. They might have came thinking that they was going to get a pumpkin or a ghost, but they got the Holy Ghost and they got Jesus Christ. And we continue to witness. But most of all, I want to report this to Zion. The people in the neighborhood, when they seen us, they said, where have y'all been? We've been looking for you. When are you coming back? When are you going to be here? But they were excited to see us in the community, and we told them we'll be back soon. We'll continue to feed the community. So in that, Zion, let's give yourselves a hand. We thank God for those that dedicated themselves to the ministry of outreach. God bless you. We know some of you had to work, but family, that's what we do. We stick up for each other. We step in when the others can't make it. God bless you all. Hallelujah. Well, today, I'm excited about the word of God, and I'm excited about the one who brings the word of God. Hallelujah. Because God has put something in her bosom for you and I. And we know that this is a praying woman of God. We know that this is a laborer in the kingdom. We know that she is an overseer, one that knows how to push pastors, how to give counsel to us. We know that she's a lawyer in the courtroom, and not only a lawyer, but an integral lawyer and an integral woman of God. Well, today, this is God's daughter, and we welcome our own overseer, Jeanette Williams White. Come on and welcome her in. God bless you.
Bless you, son. Bless you. Bless you. And to all of God's children on this day, I thank him for you, because you are yet here in the land of the living. We do honor our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, our presiding, and to our pastors, Pastor Mark and Val White, and to all of the elders and ministers. One of my baby sons was here today, and then the Lord led him right to where I'm going at in scripture. I say, now look at the unity. That's how God does it, but it makes my heart good. I looked and said, that ain't Papa. That's my son. That ain't... Anybody that knows Zion Worship Center know the great late Pastor Seaborn White. Man, he'd sit up in his chair and he'd prophesy to you from head to toe and didn't miss and was on target. But we thank God for the legacy. We do. And we do honor, and we are yet praying for Bishop Rance Allen, our family, that jurisdiction, the church. We are praying for you because we know this is a most difficult time. But one thing about it, God knows all things. And I trust him because he knows all things. So I pray for you now in the name of the Lord Jesus, wherever you are, that this word would penetrate and give you another insight into the kingdom. Amen. We're going to be coming from Psalms 133 on this morning. And it reads like this. It says, behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down upon the head, even Aaron's beard, that went down to the skirts of his garments, as the dew of Hermon and as the dew that descended upon the mountains of Zion. There you go, Zion Worship. For there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life forevermore. Now, I can stop right there, and if I was in a place, I could do a dance, because I already know there's life evermore. Even in this pandemic, there is life evermore. Even though my great Bishop Rance Allen has gone to be with the Lord, we know that he's left this present earth, but yet our hope is in the Lord, and he's into his new life, reigning with the Father. And that's where we are trying to get, into that place of hope, of life forevermore. So then we asked God what to say. And this morning my stomach was upset, and I said, I'm going to have to call my son. But just in a little while, I had started writing one message, but the Lord said, no, this is where I'm going on this morning. And the subject matter is a proclamation of unity. We see in verse 1, it says, behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. I tell you that this enemy knows that if he can divide us, then he can destroy us. But we proclaim, let it come out of your mouth, out of your belly, wherever you are, in Facebook land, Periscope, wherever you are, let it come out of your belly that you proclaim and you declare that there shall be unity in this earth. There shall be unity in the United States of America. There shall be unity here in Zion Worship Center. There shall be unity throughout the body of Christ. If unity is in effect, the enemy cannot divide us. We know that a house divided against itself cannot stand. We know that Jesus spoke to the Pharisees and said, how can Beelzebub cast out Beelzebub? Why? Because a house divided against itself cannot stand. So on this day, we rebuke the demon of disunity. We rebuke the demon that comes against the saints, seeking to destroy, seeking to tear down and tear up. So when we look at the word unity, we know that that means a coming together. And I declare on this day that the body of Christ is yet coming together. There would be some that would have you to believe that the United States is divided. And I declare that it is a lie. We have difference of opinions, but we are not divided. Our Constitution starts out by saying these United States, meaning we have come together in agreement. And I defy this damnable enemy that would broadcast that we are divided. We are not divided. I need the saints to catch that and start speaking it out. We are not divided. If you declare what the devil says and he be damned at all his enemy, the Bible says that that cometh out of a man's mouth, that you declare out of your own belly, then so shall it be. And we know that we're walking with God and we're walking with him daily in his presence, and we declare unity. We declare unity in the body of Christ everywhere. We declare unity in our households. We declare unity in our churches. The United States is not divided. That division that they would, the polarization, the animosity, they would have us to believe that there's outright hostility in this country against one another. I declare that the heavens and that the earth has come into unity. I declare that every sphere of the heavens, there is unity. One thing we know, help me, Holy Ghost, is that God knows all things. And it is his decision. It is his will that we be with him. It is his will that we live and that we be prosperous, that our spirits and our souls, our minds, our homes, our lifestyles be prosperous. He knows all things, and he wishes above all things that we prosper, our soul, our spirits, and our life. Again, I proclaim the unity of Psalms chapter 1, verse 1, 133 Psalms. When we look at the anointing here that it speaks to in Psalms, it talks about the anointing that flows down Aaron's beard. We know that during that time and even today, we anoint our pastors before we send them out with oil. We anoint, we pour on their heads oil. We soak them in the oil. But the anointing, the spiritual anointing, happens through the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is in you, the one God. He is one God. And he has been so gracious that when Jesus left, he said, I'm going to send back to you a comforter. And that comforter is the Holy Spirit. And he will lead you. He will guide you. He will teach you all things. So now we have the Holy Ghost that dwells within us. That is the anointing. That is the Spirit of God that allows us to prophesy truth. If it is not the truth of God that someone comes to with you and is going to be backed up by scripture, this Bible, if it don't come out of the Bible, it's a trick and it's a lie. There is nothing new under the sun. That's what this Bible says. Now, it takes us as human beings to accept what God has already showed us, or that that our mothers have prophesied and laid in our bellies, because we by nature are just a rebellious people. How can we be divided about wearing a mask? I'm telling you, it is a trick. A mask will give you some protection. It is not the answer to all, because my hope lies in Jesus Christ. It is his blood that covers us, that keeps away the enemy and his devices. That anointing destroys every yoke. This Bible, it teaches you that the anointing destroys every yoke. It destroys the yoke of stinginess. We don't have to trick saints for them to give their offering. The anointing, the Holy Spirit, speaks to them and teaches them to give their offering. If we are going to feed the children, as Zion did on yesterday, then the world that we're living in causes for funds. We don't have to trick them. Zion give to the people to take care of God's people. So here we are, the anointing that run down Aaron's beard, where he was anointed as a priest to walk in that office. So that same anointing, it destroys the spirit of a lie. Help me, Holy Ghost. The spirit of a lie. There is a spirit of a lie that the United States is divided. And today I proclaim that it is a lie, and I need the intercessors to walk with me in it. It's a lie. If the enemy can have us against fighting one another, I voted for Biden, yeah. But should the Lord decide, because he knows all things and he knows what's best for me, should he decide to place this other candidate back in office? Well, you know what? The Lord know all things, and I'm one of his, so he gonna take care of me. Just like the children of Israel, they were promised God. We done made promise to God, Lord, we not gonna lie no more. We not gonna steal no more. We gonna direct your people accordingly. We not gonna commit adultery. We not gonna be committing fornication. We lie to God, and as soon as Nineveh, Jonah, and the belly of whale, as soon as he lifts the pressure, we go back to doing just the things that we did. We look at Moses bringing the children out of Egypt. What happened? They couldn't even get through the desert. They couldn't get through the valleys. They couldn't even make it through the wilderness. Why? Because they could not trust God. They said, Moses, why did you take us out here? The minute they got hungry, the minute they got thirsty, they said, it'd have been better if we died in Egypt. But I proclaim and declare that we as a nation, as hard-headed as the United States is, that we shall be a people of unity. I'm not gonna let it go. Why? A nation, you claiming a nation overseer? Yeah, my God can do anything. And my God does anything. I'm not gonna ask him to give me no little job that I can get up off my rusty dusty and go get. I'm asking him for this nation. And I need the overseers, the overseers and the bishops and the priests and the pastors and the intercessors to go with me. Let's cast down this lie that has been perpetrated in the United States, that we are divided. No, we are not divided. You can have a different opinion, but let men come together and let us reason together. It is about the people of God. Even when there's no king, what do? You save the people. Without the people, there is no kingdom. So then we are looking here at Psalms and looking at our country. We shall bring healing to this nation, and we'll bring healing through unity. We will continue to feed the poor. That is our mandate. We shall continue to take care of the orphan children. We shall continue to take care of the widows. We shall do that. We shall continue to build the kingdom of God. We may be weak, but we gonna be stronger because our hope and our trust is in God. I want you to believe and know that God has this entire matter with a set date. What are you saying, overseer? I'm telling you, this will not always be this way. When you look back in history, there was the swine flu. There was HIV. There has been numerous of plagues that have come and resided in this country. Now, God could have wiped us out at any time, but he is so merciful, and he is such a precious God that he has given us time. His word says that he wished that no man, no soul be lost. He wants us all to be in the kingdom of God, and that we will sing and shout glorious hallelujahs until his return. Again, he is a God of agreement. He's a God of unity. He's a God of love. His entire word that has been written and left for us is based upon love. When you go back to Genesis chapter 1, you come through the fall of man. One thing about our God, he's a God that has already decided the outcome in eternity. So what are you saying? I'm saying that he didn't just get up this morning and decide there's going to be a plague. He knows what it takes to bring us to our knees. We would not repent as a nation ourselves. When you look at the nations in the Bible, when you look at Babylonia, it came down. Why? No repentance. Israel came down. Why? Refused to repent. The Assyrian nation came down. Why? No repentance. We must repent and come back to God and do it in right standing. We cannot be the weaklings that we've been. We allow liars to come into our churches, and we knew they were lying, but we brought them in because their name was big. And they would bring the money in. So then we got into the filthy lucre. Who has the biggest church? Who has the biggest crowd? Who has the biggest car? Who has the biggest airplane? Well, guess what? Them airplanes are sitting. The cars is sitting. Church doors are closed. There's some that think their constitutional rights are being invaded. Going back into the churches, want to do the same old, same old. But God forbid. I tell you, we must get on one page concerning this matter. And that page is that of unity. So step two, if my people who are called by my name, just examine yourself. Am I one of those people who have been called by his name? If you declare that, then you're in right standing with him. And you have the right to come to the throne of grace. If you are out of order and have been out of, as the old people would say, the ark of safety, this is a good day backslider to come back to God. He will not turn you away. His word says that he is married to the backslider. So he has not forgotten about you. He has you on his mind. The word of God said, I have you written in the palm of my hand. How can I forget you? Will a mother forget her suckling baby? No, she will not, and I shall not forget about you. He is a God of unity. His whole basis is love. Everything that he's done it because he loved us. Jesus came and died on the cross because he loved us. He did not want any of us lost. The thing about God is that he has given us the choice and then provided the opportunity through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ for us to come back to him. From the Garden of Eden, he had a plan that his son would go to the cross and would redeem us back to him. So now here is your place and here is your opportunity. Thank you, Holy Ghost. I thank him for dying for me on the cross. And the thing about it, I shall not waste it. I shall not just cast it away. But you've got to make up your mind that you're going to walk with Jesus, that you're going to be a part of his great getting up morning when he comes back. I know some don't believe that it is. I know you believe that there's other ways to do it. You know, and oftentimes when I'm talking to people, I say, you know what? If I'm fighting this hard to just to do it right, and you can get in the kingdom doing the crazy that you're doing, I feel good. I'm straight. But that's not the word of God. He wished that we all would be saved. And I believe the word of God from Genesis to Revelation. I eat the word daily. Everything in my being is about God. How can you stand? We have domestic violence at an all-time high. You got to walk with God. Your mental stability will be affected. Where you think you would not do wrong, when the opportunity presents itself, you will do wrong. If you don't walk with him, if you don't keep your family safe in the arms of God, he's a God that knows all about you, and he knows us. He knows us. It's some of us that don't know ourselves. This is a good time while you're in the Sabbath to get to know yourself. Ask God, God, reveal me to me. Because some of us think, oh, we all right. You're not all right. You don't get that great and all that holy. Perfected is the word until you get the glory. When you get all perfected, then you up out of here because there's no need for you to be here. Oh. I'm going to move from my lesson. I'm just trying to help somebody this way. You know, this morning, one of the songs we used to sing is, if I can help somebody while I'm on my way, if I can help somebody while I'm on this journey, then I know that my living is not in vain. Some of you don't know why you're here. And you ask, well, have you did any community service? Are you helping people? They don't have a clue. But God requires that we love one another. Love them little children. You know, have the hearts of the children. Love them as I have loved you. Love them as I have given my son's life for you. So that's step two, the intercessors, repentance. Isaiah says it this way, chapter 59, verse 16. He says, before he came to fight on the behalf of Israel, he says that he looked for the intercessors. Intercessors. You play an important part in the body of Christ. the gift of intercession, the gift of tapping into God, the gift of understanding the times and the seasons and knowing where we are. You're not an intercessor if you don't pray. You're not an intercessor if you don't toil in the word. You have to know his word in order to know him. How can you talk to him, but you don't know him? Intercessors. He said, then he put on his helmet of salvation. He put on his own breastplate of righteousness. And then he himself invoked judgment, and he delivered Israel. I need you to know today, he's going to deliver the United States. I know it looked hard and it looked bad right now, and the saints are leaving, and we're looking at these generals that's going off the scene. Bishop Ellis just left us a couple of weeks ago. Great man of God, Bishop Rance Allen just left us. Folk dedicated their lives to God. Well, you know what? It was their time for the Father said, enough. These hard-headed people, I need to deal with them. Y'all come on home, because I'm sick of them. And I know y'all sick of them, because I'm sick of them. So he's taking us through this testing. But know this. We're going to win. We're going to win. We're going to pray until we get it right. We're going to fast until we get it right. Zion, we fast every Thursday. Overseer fast. I get dizzy, but I fast. You all come on. You all strong and young. You all get on the wall and start fasting and quit eating so much. You can't hear God because your belly's fat. That's for Zion. So Facebook, don't y'all. That's not for y'all. That's for Zion. Zion know me. They say that's the intercessor. You know, I done got old now. So they say, oh, you know, that's the overseer. But the final point is this. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit. That is the anointing. Acts chapter 2, verse 4 through 8. On the day of Pentecost, when it had fully come, the reality of Pentecost was the Holy Spirit dwelling in the earth and infilling the bodies of the human beings. The Holy Spirit, the divine, the divinity of God that has been imparted to us, calls us not to lie, not to steal, not to commit adultery, not to commit fornication. The Holy Spirit teaches us the truth, because you know today we have classes about what truth is, because people don't know the difference between the truth and a lie. We got fact checkers that check the facts to determine what comes over your TV screen on CNN, whether it be a lie or the truth, and then they play the videotapes back. What I'm trying to tell you, just like CNN play the videotapes back, God plays the videotapes back. And guess what? You're going to get to see the replay. Don't be a liar, but cry out to God. We know our shortcomings. We want to deny them and say they're not so. That's not really who I am. Yeah, you are. You nasty. You know you're nasty. You know, but just cry out to God, because he can feel, fix that. That's one of the first spirits he's going to deal with, because he's going to deal with your heart and bring love. But in my conclusion, if you don't have the Holy Spirit, you don't need the preacher to be in a house with you. Read Acts 2, verses 4 through 8. Tell God, I am sorry, God. That's what repentance is. I am sorry, God. And I want you to come into my heart. I want to live a life that will be pleasing to you. I want to be able to walk according to your Bible, the word of God. I want to be able to follow it with great passion. I want you to help me to be able to interpret rightly the word of God. Place me, Father, under leadership, a pastor that is after your own heart, a pastor that will teach me your true word of God, unadulterated, straight off the cuff word of God, not made up, not sounding with rhythms and rhymes that makes my flesh feel good. I want to know you in a real way. I declare, oh, Bobo Shimasi, somebody I'm talking to right now on Facebook, ask God to do it for you right now. You can write to Zion. You can put it in the little comment section. You can get the number off of Zion's website. You can call and make that contact. We have intercessors, we have prayer warriors that will help pray you through. And the pastors of this ministry are outstanding. They walk with God. They don't play with his word. They will go and do their own research. They are scholars of the word. You don't want Jimmy Mac. You want a scholar, somebody who studies the word of God, someone who goes to other classes to elevate their understanding. And above all, filled with the Holy Ghost, that power that was once given unto the saints, it yet rests, rules, and abides in this earth. When Jesus comes, it's going to be too late. If you should not wake up in the morning, I don't want it to be too late. I want him to be able to say, well done, thy good and faithful servant. You have been a ruler over a few, you've done with a few, but come on up higher. I want to make you a ruler over many. God gives the ability of the charisma, the spirit of drawing, so that you can bring people into the kingdom of God. That is what, have you ever heard people sing and you say, oh, they can sing, but they don't have the anointing. What is the anointing? The anointing is the spirit of God that imparts and it prints, it moves the heart, it makes changes in people's lives. That is what you want to happen in your life. If you're a backslider, even if you say, well, you know what, I've been saved and I believe in Jesus Christ, there is a deeper, deeper walk with God. We never get it all. I see stuff after 60 some years. I see stuff in the scripture on any given day that I didn't see before. I'm a studier. I'm a scholar. That's what I do in order to do what I do in the natural and in the spiritual. So I must study to show myself a workman that need not be ashamed, but rightly dividing the word of God. I want to impart that to you. But in my concluding minutes here, I just want to say, if you don't know Jesus Christ, in the pardon of your sins, this is a good day to say, Lord, I want to know you. Please forgive me for my sins. And he's going to accept you. I accept you into my heart. I believe that your son went to the cross for me, that he died at Calvary for me. And I want to be a part of your kingdom right here in the earth. Jesus brought his kingdom to the earth through living documents and principles in the earth, how you should live. I'm living my best life. I'm living my best days in my latter life. Why? Because every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. So I'm walking with him on a continuous, constant basis, trying to hear what does he have to say? What is he saying about where we are? The spirit of wisdom belongs to God. You want God's wisdom. You don't want the wisdom of man, but you want the wisdom of God that he may lead you and guide you through this pandemic. Again, the proclamation of unity. the proclamation of unity, and I declare it to be so. And I declare it in God's heavenlies, in the earth, and under the earth. Unity to the United States of America. And we don't believe the lie of the propaganda. God, he is God. You be blessed until we meet again, back in the hands of our pastor. We love you.